My name's Ed Perlmutter. I'm congressman for the 7th Congressional District, which is Jefferson County and Adams County. And today we're continuing our Local Heroes series, where we've been fortunate to visit with a number of people throughout our community who are doing things that benefit so many of us in many, many different ways, especially during this pandemic that has really disrupted a lot of our lives. So today we're fortunate to have Shanti Meyer, who's with Stride Community Health Systems, joining us. She's the medical director for Stride. And we want to welcome you, Shanti, and tell us a little bit about yourself and what you do at Stride, and talk about Stride for a second so that the people who are viewing this video have a little more information about you guys.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Congressman. I'm so happy to be here with you today. So as you stated, my name is Shanti Meyer. I'm a nurse midwife and I have a PhD. I'm the medical director at Stride Community Health Center, and we're a federally qualified health center, and we serve all patients regardless of insurance status or residency status with primary care, which includes obstetrics, pediatrics, family practice. We also have a dental component and behavioral health, and we have care management, patient navigation. We really serve to be able to meet the needs of everyone and anybody for their primary care, dental, and behavioral health needs. And we have clinics all over surrounding the Denver metro area, and many of them are in your county, in Jefferson County. So our mission really is to be able to serve and give quality health care to anybody and everybody. And so we're very happy to be here with you today. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And you've been around the Denver metro area for some time. You operated under a different name. What was that before you became Stride?
Yeah, so we've been around for over 30 years, and we used to be called Metro Community Provider Network, or MCPN. It was a little bit of a mouthful, as you can understand. So we really wanted to kind of rebrand. We're the same company. We still do the same exact amazing work, but we really wanted just a little bit easier of a flow, and we wanted to have Community Health Center in our name, and that's why we chose Stride Community Health Center.
Well, great. And, you know, I'm familiar with you all from, you know, the east side of town, the north side of town, the west side of town.
Yeah.
Especially was with you when you did your groundbreaking and then ribbon cutting of the center that you have at 29th and Wadsworth, which mm-hmm. is my old stomping grounds. I grew up about two blocks from there. So how is that center going? And then I want to talk to you about the response that you all have made with respect to COVID-19.
Yeah, thank you. So our Wheat Ridge location on 29th and Wadsworth is just absolutely bustling. It's our second largest clinic overall that we have, and we have everything there. We've got, you know, all of the services that I mentioned before: behavioral health, dental, family practice, pediatric and obstetric services there. In addition, we have a convenient care for people who have more urgent needs. And we also have a pharmacy that you can pick up. And one of the things that we've changed with this pandemic, I know we're going to get to that in a moment, is we have moved our pharmacy so that people can just drive up and get curbside pickup so that they don't have to come into the clinic to pick up those prescriptions.
Well, let's talk about what Stride's been doing since we've had to face the corona.
Yeah.
I know Governor Polis was at the Wheat Ridge site, I think, within the last few days.
And he was.
Tell us what you guys have been doing, because you really have stepped up for our community. I want to thank you for that.
Thank you. Well, you're very welcome. It felt like a very easy decision and one that we didn't even have to think about. So we very quickly in March recognized that we, as a leader in the community health center field and just healthcare in general in Colorado, really wanted to step up and be able to meet the needs of our communities. And that really absolutely included testing. So we very quickly in the middle of March created a drive-through system, and one of our locations was up and running and continues to run today at our 29th and Wadsworth location. So, and then in April, we added on a serology antibody testing, IgG, in addition to our swab test to determine whether somebody has the active COVID symptoms and virus. In addition to that, we've also opened a special pod at our Wheat Ridge site for people who are identified as COVID positive so that they don't need to go into the hospital unless they really need to. So it allows us to still be able to meet the needs of our COVID positive patients who really need that in-person assessment but aren't quite needing to go to the hospital yet. In addition, we also very, very quickly shifted our focus from pretty much completely in-person visits to be able to do telehealth visits. And so almost overnight, we really made the decision that we wanted to keep our healthy patients healthy. And that meant at the beginning of the pandemic that they needed to be at home, but we still recognized that we wanted to reach out to them and make sure that they had their healthcare, both physical and behavioral needs met. And so we were able to very quickly institute telehealth to be able to outreach and do wellness visits over the phone, acute visits over the phone, have our behavioral health providers check in with them as well. And the other thing that I'm really proud of is we're also partnering with the homeless community in Jefferson County. And so we're also meeting the medical needs via telehealth for people who are homeless or near homeless who are staying in a respite hotel because they are COVID positive. And so again, it just really fit so easily into our mission and vision to be able to not only serve the needs of currently established patients, but also members of the community who really were needing to get tested for their safety and everybody else's safety around them.
Well, let's talk about how the community has responded to this and how your staff has responded to this, because you're here sort of on behalf of all of STRIDE and speaking on behalf of your colleagues. So how has the community responded, and how has your staff responded to this?
Overwhelmingly, it has been absolutely positive. In addition to being able to continue to serve the needs of our patients and our community, we also wanted to serve our staff. And so, with the institution of telehealth, we were able to have a lot of our staff be able to work remotely and be able to do, whatever they need to do around childcare issues and the schooling system that also went to online, and to reduce that level of exposure within the clinics. We didn't want to have full staff capacity and also have, patients coming in, because we recognize that our staff are also part of our community. We also instituted very quickly a front door screening. So every single person that enters our clinic, in addition to our staff, get screened for symptoms, get their temperature taken, so that we are really making sure that people are staying as safe as we can with the virus. And we're also giving masks if somebody doesn't have one when they're coming to the clinic, because we know that that has also been added on to the recommendations and guidance for being out in public. But our patients really, the community support for us has been just overwhelming, and people are just so grateful that we are continuing to be able to give people healthcare wherever they need to be, whether that's coming in for an immunization or reaching out to them at home and being able to address their acute needs or chronic needs or mental health needs, because that's what we do.
Well, obviously COVID-19, affects people's physical health, but yes, also a big emotional piece to all of this for folks who've had to, stay at home, and, their routine has been completely turned upside down. So I assume you've been doing a lot of sort of the emotional side, the behavioral side of it as well.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. So in addition to, our current established patients and people who are accessing us through our drive-through locations to get tested, we are absolutely outreaching with both our providers to, again, do that either follow up on results and education and information about what their test results means. But in addition, we're also having our behavioral health providers reach out and do a wellness visit around their behavioral health and mental health needs. Absolutely.
How many, I just got off of a phone call with Anthony Fauci, one phone call,
yeah,
and then Nobel economist, a guy named Paul Romer, whose dad mm-hmm. was former governor of ours. And testing is sort of key to so many things, to really getting to put this miserable disease kind of behind mm-hmm. us, make sure we're taking care of people, but also to get the economy up and running. How many tests have you all been able to administer?
So we have given, we have done over 10,000 tests as of this week. And I can tell you specifically, because I just looked it up, just about 4,000 specifically at our Wheat Ridge location, just through our drive-through and in-clinic testing that we've been doing. We're seeing still really about a 20 to 21% positive rate for the swab test, which is, it's really concerning that it's still that high. We're absolutely recognizing, unfortunately, that there's a discrepancy across racial and ethnic lines. And so we are seeing that our Black and Brown patients are having a higher rate of positives than our corresponding white patients. And that's absolutely a concern to us. In addition, with our serology testing, which is definitely a newer area of research that's coming out, our serology testing for people who are positive is really only around 5%, which to me, again, there's a lot of new information that's coming out about the serology tests, but IgG antibody results really is still pretty low in our community. And that to me indicates that this virus is absolutely very, very prevalent in our communities. And I know that the state is really working hard to ramp up the number of tests that they want to be able to do at the state level. We're doing our best and we're pretty much at max capacity right now, but we're always looking for more ways that we can really expand. And we are able to do some mobile testing. So we have a van that we've repurposed to be able to go out to specific community sites. And we've been partnering with some of the school districts to be able to do that, to test some of the employees and potentially students there before we reach the fall school system. Yeah.
Okay. Last couple questions. What does somebody have to do? I mean, what do they need to be able to, have a test, say, at the week site?
Absolutely. So thank you for that. And I know that there's been a lot of confusing information out there about who qualifies or is eligible for a test. So I want to be very, very clear from Stride's perspective. We're doing our best to follow the CDC guidelines and also the CDPHE guidelines as well. So for a swab test, you have to have symptoms, active symptoms, and that, you know, typically presents as a dry cough, fever, shortness of breath. They've added on, loss of smell and taste, muscle aches, headaches, or it just kind of keeps going on and on, the symptoms. But you have to either have active symptoms or symptoms within the last 14 days in order to be swab test. The serology testing is a little bit different because we're noticing that it does take about 14 days to have enough of the antibodies to be detected in the blood system. So we're saying for people who either have never had any symptoms at all and might be curious if they had one of those asymptomatic responses, or if they had symptoms but it's been greater than 14 days, then we can offer them a serology visit. The exception to that rule is really the priority that's been from the very beginning. If you're a healthcare worker, if you're a first responder, or if you work in a nursing home, you can still get a swab test even if you're not actively symptomatic, because we recognize that a lot of our workers in those fields are still needing to be out in the field because of the pandemic. And so we want to be able to offer testing to those people regardless of whether they have symptoms.
Does somebody need a doctor's note, or just those basic have some level of symptoms or are on the front line?
Yes, exactly. They do not need a doctor's note. We have screeners at our drive-through sites that will be able to assess people for symptoms to determine whether they're eligible for a swab test or a serology test, or whether they need to just go home and quarantine until they've passed that 14 days of potential exposure. We are not collecting any fees at all. I do want to be really clear about this. If somebody has insurance, we will be billing their insurance for the cost of the test. But outside of that, we are not collecting any money from patients or any co-pays for the testing itself. We do, as I said earlier, really like to follow up with a phone call for results to be able to give that education around what does this mean, what are your current symptoms if you have any right now. because that feels really important to us to close the loop. After you get tested, we want to be able to follow up with you for the results. But we are not collecting any fees directly from the patient for any of the testing itself or the follow-up phone calls, but we are billing insurance if they have it. It's not required for anybody to have insurance. We do ask that you bring an identification just so we can make sure that we're matching and labeling your test tube correctly and getting the results back to the right person. So we do ask that you bring some form of ID.
Well, that clearly makes, you don't need to have confusion over that.
Exactly.
Well, I just want to thank you and thank Stride for really stepping up for our community. I mean, this is a difficult time, and to have a place where there is, real effort to provide good information to people to take care of this testing component. The decision you guys made a couple of months ago, 75 days ago, to step up on the testing side, I can tell you brings, people aren't ecstatic, but it is a calming component to know that that's available amidst all of this other, disruption that we face. And so I just want to let you have the last word, but I want to thank you on behalf of my office and the people I represent for being such a great member of our community and being and representing one of our local heroes today. So I'll let you close the little segment.
Thank you. That's very sweet. I really, really appreciate it. And I think, for me as a provider and also the medical director, it really feels important that the message is out that this was something that we didn't even have to think about doing. It just so completely aligns with what we've been doing all the time, and that's really meeting the needs around behavioral and medical care and dental care to anybody who needs it. And so as a community health center, as a federally qualified health center, we really want to just be able to meet the needs of our community, and that it presented itself as a very, very important need. And unfortunately, I think it is something that we're going to be embedded in for a little bit longer than any of us initially had thought. And so we are absolutely committed to continuing to provide care to our established patients and new members in our community through the long haul for this.
Well, thank you very much. Stay healthy.
Thank you. You too.
Thanks for all the things that you're doing for us. And
you're very welcome.
All right. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye.